It's a real pleasure to be here. You know, India's home for me. It always has been. But when I look at the total chronological years and how long I've been away from, obviously I've spent more than half my life outside. But to this day, when people ask me, where am I from, the answer is very obvious. I'm from India. Very proud of my heritage and origins, and grateful for all that I represent and stand for. Today I thought, since you know, you described me as a 30-year-old veteran, 30-plus-year-old veteran, for those of you who are trying to guess my age, well, it's fairly public, but I'd like to believe I started very young, and I started when I was 5 years old, I think. So that gives you an approximate guess to my age. So I wanted to share with you some of Arista, but really take this talk beyond Arista to what do I see as some of the trends and how has networking changed. And to put this in perspective, when I joined Arista, Arista is a very young company. How many of you have heard of it? Just to get a quick, only 10%. JT, we need to do something about that. We'll give you an Arista day of training besides my 1 hour. But when Arista got started, we saw three major problems in the industry. That the networking hardware was changing every 3 years, but it was all closed application specific ASICs. But the software wasn't changing even in 20, 30 years. So, you know, hardware was closed, software was not programmable, and you've all heard, I'm sure, of SDN, software-defined networking, but nobody was really doing it. But there was a third major issue, which is the onset of a new type of customers. What Reliance has been doing in changing India's market, its service providers, needed to happen in a broad scale globally with the cloud. So a new class of cloud-based principles was really driving customers, and the big five in that has been everybody from, you know, Facebook to Amazon to Microsoft Azure to Google and Alibaba in China. So they needed a different kind of network, and nobody was building what they needed, and I think this ended up being a really important aspect of what Arista was looking to do. The other thing to look at when you build a company, and there's no greater example than Reliance, is you have to have some main characteristics. You have to build a disruptive technology. Nobody is going to come to you for anything but best of breed. You can't start a company with worst of breed, that's for sure, right? You have to be better and significantly better than what exists. You have to have a sustainable value proposition. It's very easy in tech for you to build one nice widget, but it's difficult to build multiple cycles. You can have one cycle and then miss the other. You have to have customers embrace it. We've had the fortune of having JT and equivalent customers embrace us, and we've also had. We also set a culture. We're really a company built by engineers for engineers. So you won't see airport billboard ads, which is probably why many of you haven't heard of Arista. We don't spend on branding and marketing. We spend on R&D. We spend 3 times as much as a percentage of revenue on R&D than any of the other networking customers. And hopefully that shows. You know, and sometimes that doesn't always mean we hire only network engineers. We find network engineers sometimes don't have the Python skills or the open config skills or the programmability skills. So it's easier to bring, you know, good software engineers and train them on networking than bad network engineers and detox them with and get them to do actual good software programming. So when you look at this slide on, we often success is measured by the inflection point. Inflection point is usually around IPO or when you make your first billion. It took dry as ice cream, I like ice cream, so I put that up there, 12 years to get that inflection point to a billion. It took Microsoft and Starbucks 6 years. It took Google, Cisco, eBay, Broadcom 4 years. And I think Arista and maybe Facebook are the only two that did it in 2 years. So it's pretty amazing. Thank you. And the reason we are where we are is we build great technology, but thank you for getting us there. You as customers were a big part of making that happen. Now, what did we really do? it's easy for me to get into technology, but think of what we did as really build that universal cloud network that connects your consumer and enterprise applications, whether it's Box or NetSuite or Salesforce or Netflix. All these environments are blending these days. You don't decide one set of applications are at home and one are in the business community. Some, like probably NetSuite or Oracle, are more in the business community. And you need to orchestrate all of these resources as pools that you can virtualize, that you can connect through compute, through storage. These are all workloads and machines. And they all need active communication across them. Right? The other thing that's been changing is most traffic in the web, World Wide Web, was north-south. You had client-server traffic. You were going from mainframes to client servers. Today, majority of the traffic in a data center is not just north-south, but east-west, orchestrating across workloads, workflows, and work streams. So what Arista is really doing in a simple nutshell is moving these transparently with the right availability, the right agility, the right automation, the right analytics, and the right cloud-like capabilities. So when you look at also what we're doing, you have to think these days in terms of capacity. What's good today is not good tomorrow. So on the horizontal circle, the cloud capacity is moving from terabits to 100 terabits. On the vertical circle, the intelligence is moving from basic, publish, subscribe, state-driven models to a fully automated, fully analyzed network. The more you can take humans out of the workloads, the more you can apply them to the intelligent tasks and let the technology do the talking. And this is what we've done. We've tried to implement those same cloud principles and that one button push to get your entire network. Today that doesn't happen. For any of you who's doing networking, you have to go to each switch and go poll each switch and say, how are you doing? Are you there? And then characteristics like SNMP will say, I'm fine. And you say, okay, check, next port. Third port. And then the worst thing about this is, suppose you configure everything and you finally got all your ports together on a Monday. On Wednesday, you may want to change some configurations. You have to go back again to every port and go port by port, switch by switch. Getting that turnkey change control so that everything on Monday can be shifted to Wednesday or moved back to the Monday configuration through a click of a button can remove often 300 engineers down to 3 engineers. We have examples, numerous examples, where we were able to bring the automation down from 60 days to 6 hours to 20 minutes. Right? These are real examples. And that sometimes people get scared when I say, and they go, what do we do with all these people? You move your people to higher level architectural tasks. There's always work, but you don't want them doing the highly repetitive tasks. You want the CapEx and the OpEx to really match. The horizontal cycle is the CapEx. The vertical cycle is how do you reduce more of your OpEx. Now, another inspiration for us was, you know, I'm sure you all know Amazon and what they do. One of the most gigantic companies worldwide. And they proved to be an inspiration for us. What Amazon does, and today, you know, with the shopping experience, with the storage experience, is what Arista wanted to do for networking and our software experience. So you can think of us as the Amazon of networking. And unlock as many of your applications, whether they're on the premise or on the cloud, the network should be transparent. And then another very timeless inspiration for us was Apple. You have to be able to describe your portfolio in a simple 2x2 matrix. Of course, Apple has the iPhone and the watch and everything, but when you look at even their consumer products, you can, or your their laptop products, it's very easy to describe it in that 2x2 matrix. And being able to do that is important no matter how big and how complex you get. Because you know, the average consumer has to be able to consume this information and be able to implement it and do something about it. So making tech simpler was a very important goal. And then another goal was recognizing the trends. Today, more and more of us are not just communicating on text or email or SMS or WhatsApp, which we certainly do, but it's more and more video and content, right? So the ability to transform that content to a highly digitized infrastructure is really important. I lost one screen, I'll go to the other. And in 2005, this video streaming was only 9 billion streams. Streaming hours. In 2015, it's already grown to 50 billion. Any predictions on what it's going to be in 2020? A trillion streams. How are you going to deal with all that information? How are you going to have the right access? The network plays a pivotal role in dealing with these workflows. Now, many people talk about the cloud. And the cloud has changed the way we consume information, the way we, you know, drive our electric cars, the self-driving cars, the way we enable smart grid, the way we do our hotel reservations or our room reservations in Airbnb. But yet, I think it's only now in the first innings, because all of these devices and users means we've had to scale the cloud. But we've hardly begun to deal with the interaction of all these applications. Most of these are still in silos. So I believe that even though we talk about the cloud like it's been going on for a long time, much of it, you know, as you assume, baseball has 9 innings, we're in the first inning. If you assume cricket, we're not even in the first inning. So it depends on the game you're playing. And this is a critical aspect. Now, when I think of what Arista brings to all of these trends, I think there are 4 or 5 things I want to leave you with in technology and why this matters. The first thing we did was we cut down all these tiers of network. All of you must know access, aggregation, core, and each layer often has 2 or 3 sub-layers. Arista was able to make that a very flat, fat topology. That's a key part of saving costs, because the less you're interconnecting between all of this, the better. The other thing we took to heart is high availability. In today's industry, high availability usually means put 2 of everything, so that if one fails, the other takes over. In our environment, high availability means have active paths, not 2 of everything, but have an active path for everything. You should never be wasting your bandwidth cycles or your path cycles. You should always be using them. But when one fails, everything should be able to quickly move. This is, you know, unlike a Christmas tree light, since we just had Diwali and Diwali lights, if one bulb fails, what happens today? Whole thing comes down. Right? In the Arista published subscribe software stack model, if one bulb fails, we automatically detect the state. We go in and actually repair that bulb. So you never have the issue. It's always on. It's always auto-correcting. There's self-healing resilience. There's live patching. And this makes a huge difference in both the amount of gear you buy and your fast recovery time, because we've got constant information on the state of every aspect of our network. The other important trend is any cloud, any workload. Today, it would be very difficult to think of building a network without considering what's going on with the cloud. You can do it, but every CIO is challenged to understand how much does it cost with the cloud, how much does it cost on your premises. And the reality is the cloud often looks cheaper, because if you're only consuming a few workloads, you could end up spending $6,000 a month. The real time the cloud escalates is when your usage fee model goes up. Most people don't tell you that, right? So I've had banks start at $6,000, then they end up at $600,000 a month, and soon it's $6 million a month. And if you're spending $6 million a month, you better be thinking of how to do it in your premises as well, because you're basically you're renting a property, you're not owning a property, and your costs just skyrocketed, and you didn't get the right depreciation cycle. However, the right way to do this would be figure out what workloads should sit on your premise, what should go on the cloud, well, how do you control the usage model, and get the best of both. So you can do cloud bursting and toggle across. Simple workloads probably make sense in the cloud. Your really complex, mission critical, highly secure assets, definitely you want to build on the premise. And do not hand basically the keys to your kingdom to one cloud vendor. Always go multi-cloud. Often I used to say SDN, you know, means still don't know. But today, the definition of software-driven networking is really automation and programmability, right? If you can build the right programmability so that you can automate not just across one switch, but the entire flow, then you can analyze, you can visualize, and you're always correlating these informations. That is ultimate definition of SDN. And that requires a completely new thinking. You can't be box by box. You have to think network-wide. You have to think software stack. You have to think open source. You have to think containerization. You have to think, how do I connect it into a bare metal workload, a virtual workload, a physical workload, or an IoT sensor. So it's not easy, because that means, you know, and most importantly, you have to think of it without a proprietary lens. Just open up all the APIs and make sure that if you're not building something, others can connect to it. And then the last but not least is analytics. This is probably second to automation. It's one of the hottest areas right now, because everybody's building their own analytics silo. Splunk does one thing, you know, data monitoring devices to another, and there's no correlation or no ability to even collect the data, let alone do some actionable things with it. So this is an area that Arista is investing strongly in, and we truly believe this has to be multi-vendor. This can't be one Arista does ourselves, because we, you know, we can do it across the network, but what do you do for security? What do you do for WAN optimization? What do you do for storage? So this is one that the whole vendor community has to focus on. And this, in essence, is what we call. These five pillars represent to us not just software-defined networks, but software-driven networks. So let me give you a quick example of each one. Is this too technical? Is this okay? Yeah, okay. So let me give you an example of, for example, how we defined leaf spine. In 2010, a leaf spine was, we built a 10 terabit switch. And it's the first time actually that spines were pioneered by Arista. And we said spines should be completely non-blocking. They should not be, I'm blocking on some ports, I'm not on others. So we said, give me full non-blocking, give me wire speed, and pack as many 10 gig ports. At that time, we were having the 1 gig to 10 gig transition. And this was called the 7500, and it's the flagship product. We won many awards for it. In 2013, in 3 years, we were able to increase the capacity by 30 terabits. And now the compute was not just 1 gig, but 10 gig, and the spine was no more just 10 gig, but 40 gig. 3 years later, no surprise, one more 3x. This is how fast technology moves. And then you think of when you depreciate your equipment, when you think of your equipment, you have to think in cycles of 1 to 3 years, right? The R went one step further. Not only was it a 115 terabit chassis with the 100 gig spines and 10 or 25 gig links, it was the first time we were combining switching and routing. What's a switch? What's a router? What's a LAN? What's a WAN? All these lines got blurred. And this, and so you can expect us to continue to do that again. If we continue this progression, 2019 should be an exciting year one more time, right? And the nice thing about these things also is, this is the crossover we see. In the old days, crossovers took 5 to 10 years to happen. You can see here between the 7500E and the 7500R, how quickly we went forward. This was literally in 1 year. So never be afraid to eat your young and migrate scale as fast as you can, because technology is only getting faster, simpler, and more cost efficient is the message on that. The network rollback and migration is another key step. This is the high availability. You have to be able to take your workloads. CloudVision is a product we developed to do this. Again, full open APIs. And what we're able to do with that, as I said, is go look at Monday's workloads, Friday's workloads, and move across VMs, containers, and physical switches, and give you the full turnkey management. So whether it's and mobility across that. Today, when you want to do that, the VMs have their vCenter. The physical switches you have to look at through Cisco. The containers you have to look at through Docker or Kubernetes. Each one is a silo. And this completely removes the silo from any workload to any workflow to any workstream, making it transparent for you. You should be able to grow with any consumption model, whether it's physical, virtual, or containerized, and that's the key, seamless mobility. Now, the cloud apps also need, you hear a lot about machine learning, and we weren't smart enough to call it machine learning. But the reality is, you have to build that database model where every device, you consume the data and then you store it. But then, when you store it, how do you know what's useful and what's not? So what you end up doing is storing a lot of data. And some of it may be good data, some of it may be false positives, some of them may be false negatives. So instead of the old SNMP ways, what you do with that data is first you trigger the workloads and look for events. Rather than SNMP, you look for events and say, is there anything going on? In Arista, what we do is we actually set up watermarks. You can do the same and say, if something's going on badly, give me a trigger, and then I'll act on it. If something's not, then just keep going. Then if you reach that trigger, capture it and present that data. And then some of them may be real time enough that you have to immediately know what's going on and send an alarm. So when you say in data analysis or deep learning, it isn't one stroke for all folks. You have to actually tier it into grades and deal with it in three different ways. And you also have to be serious about how you work in partnership. I think the days where networking was a box delivered with one, you know, hardware, one software, and one management all coming from one vendor, and vendor lock-in is gone. That has to be challenged, because what happens then is you don't get the best of breed, you get one singular thought, which could be, depending on how that product is doing, a mediocre breed or a lesser breed. So Arista's goal with Cloud Vision is you all should be sitting in the beach, clicking a button and getting all this data, not just from one vendor, but really turnkey all of your five A's, which is availability, automation, analytics, agility across any cloud. Now, one of the things we haven't done in Arista, it's important when you think of what we do to also tell you what we don't do. We don't try to do everything. Security is one of those things we don't do well. And why is it we don't do well? Because security has always been trying to attack the cyber threat of the day, right? You have to have a very full-time focus, whether it's Palo Alto or Checkpoint or Fortinet or host-based security, you know, on what do you do for a DDoS attack? What do you do in the cloud? What do you do in an enterprise premise? What do you do with a mobile device? And each of that requires unique expertise. So Arista decided early on, we're not the cyber threat of the day company. Somebody else has to do that. However, cyber threat of the day company is a little bit like getting different viruses and different diseases. Each one of them has their own pattern. But what Arista can do is mitigate it and protect the infrastructure from the cyber threat of the day. And that's where we focus. We focused on not doing security as a noun, but security as an adjective, making it more secure. And segmentation is a key part of making it secure. If you can isolate the network and say, okay, you got that disease and somebody trapped it, somebody else besides us, then how can we make sure that doesn't mitigate and spread and become a widespread disease across the entire network? That is as important. Too much, too many times for compliance reasons, you will find yourself spending more money on security than on mitigation. And it forces you to rethink the architecture. And that's what Arista did. We said it doesn't matter where it comes from, the cloud, the DDoS enterprise. We can look at that data, we can look at the flows, and then we can make sure with macro segmentation, we tell you we detected a threat and contain the spread. And this has been a key part of what we've done with VMware, with our security vendors, and now with cloud vendors. So we look at security really as micro segmentation, working with VMware on the VMs, macro segmentation to deal with physical to physical and physical to virtual across Arista switches or non-Arista switches as well. And then zone segmentation, where you can work with AWS and the cloud vendors to make sure that anything that goes there is also protected. Three layers of the onion, if you will, that you have to peel to think about this architecturally rather than on a point feature basis. And the same thing on any cloud. Nobody is going to just go full on cloud. The hybrid cloud is the only way to implement this, which means you have to think of your, we were talking to JT earlier, how do you think of your remote offices? Now, network function virtualization is becoming very important. The branch is no more just an SD-WAN, it's an SD branch or an SD cloud. And you need to be able to move between the security, the data center, or the cloud center, and your remote branches in a very seamless fashion. And it's multiplied by the fact that there are at least three major cloud vendors. So dealing with the traffic analysis, tracing the flows, understanding the latency, the HTTP response time, the packet loss, becomes very key between these multiple clouds and the premise. And this is a lot of what Arista is doing. So I go through all this detail to finally come back to, okay, what is my vision? My 2020 vision is, you know, networking is profoundly changed in the last, particularly 5 years, than it did the last three decades. And there's at least four changes going on. First is silo apps, users, devices, which were all different. You know, if you came from the mainframe world or the client side world, they were all different. It's transforming. And really what you're dealing with today is the killer workload or the work X apps. They may be different for each of us. It may be gaming, it may be media, it may be cloud apps, it may be basic email, it depends, right? Places in the network, you had different networks for data center, for campus, your branch, your core. But they're all moving to Ethernet, they're more moving to switching and routing. Why do you need to build four separate siloed places in the network? You can have one. They are becoming what we would call places in the cloud. They're converging. You can have the same spine architecture with different leaves for the branch, the spine, storage. What's a LAN? What's a WAN? What's a SAN? Before you had, what's a MAN? Well, we all know what's a MAN. But what are these? They all used to be individual technologies. Sometimes you had Ethernet and token ring, and SAN you had fiber channel, and the optical transport layer you had layer one. Increasingly, it's becoming Ethernet everywhere. Ethernet is a technology. It's the most widely used, billions of units proliferated, great at troubleshooting, and is scaling at speeds beyond 400 gig today. People are already defining, you know, a terabit of Ethernet on the high end, and still 100 megabit, not even 1 gigabit Ethernet on the low end. And finally, you shouldn't have to, this shouldn't be a PhD exercise in networking. Layer one, layer two, layer three just means, how do you view packets? Do you view them at the serial physical layer, at the MAC address layer, or the IP address layer? And they should not require different boxes. They should be options. And if you put these four things together, you've really built a modern cloud network that's not just for the cloud world, but it's for every world. It may just come in different shapes and sizes. And so I think that's very exciting. And it truly transforms networking from the 2000 era, which was mostly connectivity. And we all came from that era, where our parents asked, what did we do? And we'd have a tough time explaining what we did with networking, because we're dealing with the internet and the first generation, to automating, which is I think where we are today, to truly interacting. This is where we want to be in the future. So that the vision really translates into. And I think, you know, Arista is not only in the middle of this transformation, but each and every one of you are responsible for making this technology transformation deployable. That's the next challenge. And I believe these places in the network, whether it's a data center, whether it's a public cloud, or whether it's a campus, will truly transform into PICs. PINs will become PICs, and bring that consistency of software across all of these layers. Now, when you do that, there's a real benefit. I told you how we were able to get days to hours to minutes across the network. But not only minutes, we are seeing improvements with availability where you can do the boot up time into seconds, and you can even in real time go into real time microseconds or nanoseconds. This is the brightness of what you're really dealing with. And so the question to all of you is, do you want to spectate this or do you want to be part of it? You know, one of the things that Elon Musk did, I know he's in the news for a lot of other reasons, but he truly built an innovative car. I used to always tell my husband when he got me this car, I said, well, this is just a large iPad on wheels with an electric battery. But he changed the way people think of cars. And as a result of that, the car cloud is emerging, self-driving autonomous vehicles are emerging, and even Detroit, Michigan, with the car industry, which is down in the doldrums, has changed. He built that modern car. And, you know, so building that market-making technology, whether it's in cars, whether it's in networking, takes thinking of technology, you know, differently and transforming it in a very, and we share the straits and we seize that opportunity. And I think what we can do together is really develop not just the technology, but the leader in you. This was a slide that when I did one of my talks, they sent to me, and they said, how do you make this happen? And I have some very strong philosophies on how you make it happen. But one of the things across the way is do the right thing. You know, don't become a victim of something tactical you have to do. Step back and look at the strategy. And if it's right for your customer to wait and skip a generation of technology, do that. If it's right for your customer that they have a quality issue and you're not ready with your product, be clear to tell them that. There's no worse thing than hearing bad news and then having to go course correct it, right? So retain that culture, which means disrupt, but develop the leader in you and develop that five things you're going to do to make that disruption possible. Because probably the biggest reasons people don't do disruption is risk. Nobody gets rewarded for failing. And taking a risk is always a bigger difficulty than incrementally doing what you're doing. When I get 100 engineers, I can always say, I'll put them on this feature and incrementally do something. But what Arista did was say, no, I won't do that incremental thing. I'll step back and make those 100 engineers, 1,000 engineers, and build a software stack. That means we took our time, but in the long run, that paid huge dividends, right? And especially in the United States, and I'm sure it's true in all public companies, we live by the quarter. Of course, we have to deliver numbers to the quarter. But if you Sacrifice the short term and not build the wrong term, you cannot build a real foundation. And that's true of networking, that's true of people, that's true of companies. So, you know, change that focus. And by the way, customer driven doesn't always mean that everything JT tells me we do. It has to be a dialogue. We have to say, you know, it makes sense for you, but maybe it doesn't make sense if you look at this in a 3-year horizon. So that combination of doing the right thing, building a disruptive transformation technology, and delivering it to the customers in a way that's strategic, but and not tactical, and not just trying to solve the immediate fire, I think really defines the leader in each one of you. And that's how we've done it. In Arista, we lead by example. We want that self-empowerment, if you will. You know, and most of you, you know, as we become grown adults, we don't need to be managed daily, but we want guidance and mentorship and leadership. So you can self-manage yourself and then look for the other 20% where you need the guidance and leadership. And I thought I'd end with that, because I think so many times we all talk about technology, but the patterns to make technology work are always the same, which is culture, do the right thing, build a good technology, and then keep iterating to make it strategic, not incremental.